The slide which you are seeing is what we have done last time, correct? If you just look at the even a previous slide, in the box, this W2 is given. That is the second order correction introduced because of the perturbation H dash. So this is the second order term for energy eigenvalue. Same way, when we do some mathematics, last time we have seen that this V2, that is the second order correction to eigenstate or eigenfunction, that also we have obtained. So now we have V2, that is the eigenstate or eigenfunction. We have W2, that is the second order energy eigenvalue. Previously, we have also obtained the W1 and V1. So if you know, that is what I was mentioning just before, that if you know W0, V0, that is the zeroth order term, you will be able to calculate W1 and V1, the first order terms. Once you have with you the first order term, you can go for the second order term. And then you go for the third order term and higher order terms if required. But in the beginning also, I have mentioned that if your perturbation, this H dash, is very small quantity compared to H0, then practically there is no need to go beyond second order term. There are few cases where people have also tried, scientists have also tried to compute third order term, like this W2 and V2, they have computed W3 and V3. But practically, the corrections which we get due to the third order term is very, very small and we can ignore it. So we can say that to a modest level of accuracy, the second order term is sufficient. So if you know W2, V2, your answer will be sufficiently accurate. And that is what we have done, but in the mathematical formalism. There is one example which we have considered previously, that of the, say, an harmonic oscillator, right? I just go back and try to remind you that this is the example which we have considered, that where such a problem of an harmonic oscillator can be found in a real life. And we know that there are many examples like diatomic molecules or, say, interaction among the atoms. So atomic spectra or diatomic spectra are the few examples where the potential energy can be drawn like this, and we have now a very close to this problem, exactly solvable problem, and that exactly solvable problem is nothing but the harmonic oscillator. So if you solve this harmonic oscillator problem, then we are in a position to find out what is the enharmonic correction to this diatomic molecule or the atomic molecule spectra, right? So this is the one practical example that we try to observe for the first order term. Now, since we have obtained the second order term, as you can see here, this second order term W2, the energy correction to second order term, and even V2, that is the second order correction to the eigenfunction, is ready. We can now try to see the examples of second order corrections. But before that, as I was mentioning last time also, we can now develop a perturbation theory for the degenerate case. Whatever up till we have discussed was for, say, non-degenerate case. That means corresponding to each and every energy eigenvalue, there exists only one energy eigenstate. So if energy, if you write as EM corresponding to H0 unperturbed Hamiltonian, then there will be only one eigenfunction, only one eigenstate UM that we can write. But now if you have a degenerate case, and we know what is the meaning of degeneracy, that your energy eigenvalue has a same has a single value, but your eigenfunctions may be many. And in that case, your V0, that is the zeroth order term for the total eigenstate, can be expanded, can be written as a linear combination of all this UM. And don't forget, these UM states are nothing but the eigenstates of a Hamiltonian H0. They all will give the same energy, EM. And just to make it more visualizable, to convince you, I am considering only the doubly degenerate case. So I assume that there are two states, which I will call as a UM1 and UM2. This both the states UM1 and UM2 give you the same energy EM. You can see on the beside panel, you can see here my cursor is moving. I have shown that H0 when operates on UM1 or H0 operates on UM2, energy is the same. But states are different. So you can say that this is the doubly degenerate states. Right? And using these two states, UM1 and UM2, now I'm defining my V0. Correct? So my V0, the zeroth order term for the total Hamiltonian H can be expanded, can be written as a linear combination of this UM1 and UM2. And the coefficients which are coming here, we write as a A10, A20. Again, on the as a superscript, in the bracket, whenever I write a 0, you understand it is the zeroth order term. So A10 and A20 are the zeroth order coefficients for this linear expansion or for this linear combination. Right? So my UM1 and UM2, which are the eigenstates of H0, which are the basis for H0, they are used to expand my V0. Once you have a V0, obviously, we are actually finding, say, the first order correction. So for the first order correction, I also require to know what is the eigenstate function V1. Right? And here you can see this eigenstate function V1, we can write in a similar way what we have done for the non-degenerate case. Like CN1 UN, you can see the first term, this first term itself is similar to what we have written previously. Right? Only additional thing which we are writing is the linear combination of UM1 and UM2. So my first order term to the eigenstate function, that you can write like the CN1 UN, the first term, and then there are two terms, the linear combination, which I write. But just appreciate the difference here. In the above equation, it was A1 zero order, A2 zero order, but here I am writing this A1 first order, A2 first order. Right? And here the prime indicates that your N will not take both the values here, this M1 and M2, these two values will not be considered in the first summation. In total, you are now considering all the states. N can take all values, but not M1 and M2. So this M1 and M2 two terms now I'm writing separately. So everything is included, but not in this first term, but separately. So if someone wants to know what is V1, then eventually you require to know what are A1 and A2 here, correct? If you know this A1 and A2, you can say that your energy eigenstate for the first order term can be calculated. And then my first order equation, which I think we have written earlier, I think we have developed a perturbation series, perturbation theory, you can see here. This three equations which I'm going to use frequently. Now I'm solving the first order term. So this middle equation, equation number two, that is what I'm solving. H0 V1 and this V1 term I'm bringing on the left side. So this blue line part I'm writing together and red wavy line parts I write together. So this is the same equation now I'm using to solve my first order equations. So you can see this last equation is something like H0 V1 minus W0 V1 and so on and so forth. And you know that this V1, I can write like this, which I have just mentioned. W0, that is the zeroth order energy term, which we know can be written as EM, as we have already done previously. The same thing, same method I am following. For V0, now we have something slightly different form. This is the V0 equation. So instead of this V0, in the next step, I will write this equation and V1, I will write like this. So it is only a substitution of this V0 and V1 in this equation. Right? That is what I have done. So in the first term, yes. And what I'm doing, this H0 and W0 both have a V1 term. So I can write them combinedly, writing V1 common here also in this last two term, this V0, I will write common. So you can see here, this H0, W0, I have written combinedly. And for V1, now I am writing this expression. Don't forget here, now V1 is made up of actually three terms. First term with a sigma sign plus these two terms. That means for every time when you write V1, you will have now three terms. One corresponding to this first sigma sign and other two terms. So that is what I have done. So this part, the first term is corresponding to my sigma sign, whereas the second and third term is due to the other part of my V1. So you can see I have done the replacement of V1 by this previous equation. This equation now I am using for these two terms here. Correct? So that is what I have done. W0, as you know, it is nothing but just the number. It is just the energy eigenvalue. So what happens, this H0, when you open up this bracket, W0 will remain as it is. But when H0 operates on UN, it will give ENUN. So finally, EN comes here instead of H0 after this operation. And W0, I can write as EM. So you can see in the next step, in the next term, you can have EN, EM. And of course, same thing you can do for the other other terms also. Correct? This H0 when operates on UM1, but here you know that when H0 operates on UM, you can see here and beside H0 when operates on UM1, it will give energy EM only. Similarly, when H0 operates on UM2, it will give energy EM. So what happens here that when this H0 operates on UM1, the energy will be EM. And we know this H0 contributes EM, W0 itself is EM, so EM minus EM, so this will be zero. Similarly, for the this second part also, this will be zero. So in the next step, you can see I am writing 0, 0. At the same time, after operating all this thing, I am now multiplying from the left the Bray UM1. I think you see the same procedure we have followed there. Only difference is that now we have a two state functions, UM1 and UM2, who defines my V0. Earlier it was only one. So we had taken a scalar product only one time. But since my V0 is now written as a UM1 and UM2, combination of two terms, so I have to do the scalar product with UM1 and for UM2 both. So here I am first I am taking with, say, scalar product with UM1. So now in the above equation, from the left, this UM1 will multiply. So that is what I have done. Right? But don't forget, at zero, when operated, it gives only the number EN. So all these numbers I write first, and the scalar product now I will obtain as UM1, UN, as EM minus EM, this second and third term contribute zero. So I have written 0, 0. Here, where my cursor is moving, you should be a little careful. Here, in fact, I am opening up this bracket, this H dash UM1 and W1 UM1. But now from the left, when UM1 is coming and multiplying, so what we have in this term, A10, which is a constant term, but UM1, H dash, which is here, and of course, from the right, there is a UM1. So we have a term like this, A10, UM1, H dash UM1 for this part. Similarly, now when you do for this W1 term, W1 UM1, that is what I am writing. A0, because of this minus sign, it will be negative. A10 as it is. Don't forget, W1 means it is the first order correction to energy. And you know that if it is a first order correction to energy, it is just the energy eigenvalue. It's only the value. And if it is a value, so you can write it outside this scalar product. So in this, A10 minus W1, which I write in front, and now from the left, UM1 is multiplying, so it is the scalar product between UM1 and UM1. Similarly, I do for the second part with coefficient A20, H dash, and now you can see the scalar product between UM1, H dash, UM2, and for the other part, it is A20, W1 with a negative sign, I keep constant, and the scalar product between UM1, but now, on the right side, it is UM2. And we now abbreviate certain notations. We can make the notations simple. So this term, UM1, H dash, UM1, which I can write as H dash 1, 1, or as per the textbook which I am following, the quantum mechanics by Venkatesan and Matthews textbook, they have written this matrix element as a small H 1, 1. So in the next step, this quantity um1 h dash um1, that is the matrix elements of h dash between states um1 and um1, that I will write as a small h11. Similarly, this term, the sandwich of h dash between Bray um1 and Cat um2, that I will write as h12. Left side I write as a I'll write first, so um1 1 is there, so this matrix element will read as h12, right? And then I will use the orthogonality conditions, orthogonality properties of this eigenstates um1 and um2, right? You know that this um1 and um2 are the eigenstates of the unperturbed Hamiltonian H0, and they are orthogonal to each other. So if they are orthogonal to each other, obviously I can write this um1 Bray um1 Cat um2 as delta m1 m2. So I use all this delta properties. Um1 and um, they are not same, therefore their scalar product will be zero, so this first term will be zero. Similarly, here um1, so it is delta m1, m1, obviously it will be 1, whereas here it is delta m1, m2, so this term contributes 0. So if you collect all non-zero terms, then what you are left with is that this everything where my cursor is moving, first term is 0, second term 0, third term 0, but this term a1 0 and this small h11 will be there. Similarly, here a1 0, w1 will be there. So this two term I write together, keeping a1 0 constant, then my first two terms will be h11 minus w1 a1 0. And of course, this term will also be there. So we can write a2 0, and this element, matrix element, I can write as h12 equals to 0. So this equation number 1, which I have written, is nothing but when I obtain the scalar product from the left by Bray um1. This first equation, which was multiplied from left by um1, results in equation number 1. But instead of um1, if I do the same calculation, if I repeat my calculation with say Bray um2 rather than um1, um2, and if I do the simplification, what I will get is the second equation. Obviously, now from left, um2 is coming, so my all matrix elements will have a first subscript 2. Earlier it was h11, h12, 1 is coming first. But now since you are multiplying from left, Bray um2, so the matrix elements will look like h21 and h22. So my equation number 2 is nothing but the simplification of above equation when multiplied scalarly with Bray um2. So I have now two equations, and both of them have a1 0, a2 0. So can I say that it is the simultaneous linear equation? And why linear? Because there is no there is a power 1 only. So this equation and 1 and 2 are known as a linear simultaneous equations for a1 0 and a2 0. And now we know, after spending some time you know that the same equation 1 and 2 can be coupled, can be written together in this determinant form. You can see, if you open up this determinant, you will get the both the equations. This h11 minus w1 a10 plus h12 multiplied by a20, so it will give you the first equation. So basically this is a homogeneous linear two equations. And you know that this equations will be non-trivially solved. Obviously, this, if you take a10 and a20 will be 0, then nothing to be done. It is a foolish thing. It is a trivial thing. If you take a10, a20, then there is no v0. If there is no v0, there is no higher order terms, and nothing can be obtained. So practically, you get nothing if you assume a10 and a20 0. So this is not allowed because it's a trivial, it's a meaningless thing. So if this are not 0, then this two terms when multiplying and giving you 0 means the determinant, secular determinant, this determinant should be 0. And therefore now we have a 2 cross 2 determinant that will be 0. And you know that how to solve the determinant. one I have shown broken line. So this multiplied by this term minus this multiplied by this term. So this diagonal elements multiplies minus this off diagonal or this another diagonal elements multiply. That's what I have done. So H11 minus W1 into H22 minus W1 this term minus H12 into H21 that is equals to 2. And if you open a bracket, you can see this W1 and W1, so it will be W1 square which comes. And don't forget, our goal is to obtain the solution for the first order. First order theory requires two things: first order correction to energy eigenvalue W1 and first order correction to energy eigenstate V1. So W1 is my subject, W1 is my interest, and therefore now I will write this equation. I open up this bracket and you can see this is the equation which I get, and it is nothing but your quadratic equation, something like ax square plus bx plus c equals to 0, where x means W1, right? So this W1 I can obtain, and you know that can be obtained by this method, something like what you have done in the 9th or 10th standard. This quantity which I have written in the bracket raised to whole half, where I have actually added and subtracted this 4 H12 and H21 term so that I can make this last term in the perfect square. So what I have done, this term I have just slightly modified by adding and subtracting this 4 times H12 and H21, and that minus 4 H12 and H21 which I have subtracted, I merged, I just combined with this so that I can write this term as a perfect whole square. Right, this is nothing but your term, something like b square minus 4ac, discriminant, right? And this plus or minus. So you have now two solutions. When you take plus sign, you'll have a one solution. If you take a minus sign, you'll have another solution. So here what you get, the answer for W1, the solution for W1, first order correction to energy, will have now two possible values. Of course, if this term, the discriminant, is zero, then it will have only one term. But otherwise, in general, whenever this term, square bracket term, is non-zero, then your W1 will have two values, one with a positive sign, one with a negative sign. So these two solutions I may write as a W1 plus and W1 minus. What it means when you get the first order correction as the two values, two answers, when you get, what it means, that is the interesting physics. When you write now total energy, which we symbolize as a W, then W can be written as a zeroth term, already known, because it is energy EM of the unperturbed part of Hamiltonian, plus whatever correction comes, whatever additional term we get due to the H dash term due to the perturbed part of Hamiltonian, that I will write as a W1. So the total energy when corrected up to the first order can be written as W0 plus W1. And you now know that W1 itself is having two possibilities, because W1 has two answers, one with a positive sign and one with a negative sign. So this total energy W will also have a two possible answers: EM plus W1 plus and W minus, that is the second energy eigenvalue, I can write as EM plus W1 but with a negative sign. So your energy levels are not corrected with a single value, but they are corrected with the two possible answers, W1 plus and W1 minus. So this W will also get the two values, two answers. So something like that, you have a single energy states EM, but now EM is added by some plus term and EM is subtracted by another term. So obviously that energy level EM is no longer unique. EM is no longer remain single valued, but it will have now two values, EM plus something and EM minus something. So can I say that your single energy level, single energy EM, is now get splitted? It is no longer the same single energy level. Now instead of that, you have EM plus something and another is EM minus something. So this is something additional, extra information that we deduce whenever you apply the perturbation theory to degenerate case. In our case, you can see, just for simplicity, we started with a doubly degenerate state. And you know what do we mean by doubly degenerate states? There are two states, but energy is the same. So actually what is happening, that states are same, but they are giving the same energy. That means the energy value or energy eigenvalue of both the states are coinciding. Though it appears as a single energy EM, but the contribution comes from UM1 as well as UM2. So being two states, different states, they are giving same energy. So your energy eigenvalues are overlapping. EM because of UM1, EM because of the UM2, both are coming at the same place, at the same level. But now when you apply perturbation, let us say, as Kenil was asking in the beginning, we can apply the perturbation due to electromagnetic radiation, or we may apply the perturbation due to the temperature, or we may perturb the systems mechanically. Then in all this case, this perturbation has done what? What is the role of this perturbation? The energy levels which were appearing as a single energy levels, now they are appearing as a separate energy levels, EM plus something and EM minus something. So your energy levels are no longer remaining the same single energy value, but rather they get splitted. So the role of perturbation is always to split the energy levels. And in the language of, say, spectroscopy, we say that now energy levels are splitted, means energy levels are now decoupled. You say that the degeneracy is removed, or you can say that the role of perturbation is to lift the degeneracy. What do you mean by degeneracy? States are many, but energy levels are same. But now what happens, because of the perturbations, even energy levels are also splitted, energy levels are also different. So to summarize this entire theory, perturbation for non-degenerate case and perturbation for degenerate case, if I just summarize, in the case of non-degenerate case, I have made one statement that what is the role of perturbation when you have, say, non-degenerate, and now we can include even a degenerate case also, that in general, the role of perturbation is to shift the energy levels. Your energy level will now change its value. It can be either lifted or it can be lowered. Not only the shifting, we have seen here, there is a splitting also. Your total W is now splitted into two parts, EM plus something and EM minus. So both the thing is observed whenever perturbation is acting. Shifting, one thing, and another is the splitting of things. Splitting of the energy level means you can say that perturbation has now removed that degeneracy. All states may have now separate different energies. This separation here takes place in two values, EM plus something, EM minus something, because you were considering the doubly degenerate states. So there were two states and therefore you obtained two different energies. If you have a three states, then your energies may be splitted into three. If you have R states, then if your degeneracy is R full degeneracy, then obviously your energy eigenvalues will be splitted into R different values. But not necessarily that it will always separate into R. If some of the eigenvalues are same, then you can say that it may be either equal to or less than the number of degeneracy. If there are 10 states, then our expectation is that perturbation should split all 10 states with the 10 different energies. But it is possible that some of the energy may come same. Let us say three states are coming with the same energy. Then the total decoupling, total separation will not be 10, because still three states have the same energy. Remaining six have different energies. So total splitting is only 7. Six separate energies and three, a group of those three states having the same energy. But generally, the role or the action of this perturbation is to split the energy levels and is also to shift the energy levels. This shifting and splitting of the energy levels, we say that you are now removing the degeneracy. So that is the very important aspect, and how this removal of the degeneracy due to the application of perturbation. That is the very important aspect, and we will see like the familiar effects from your lower standard, the Stark effect or the Zeeman effect, which we are learning. This is exactly what is happening by applying the external electric field or by applying the external magnetic field. Our idea is to perturb the system. And as we have realized now, as we have done the mathematics, you can see as your system is perturbed, their energy levels, which appears to be single energy levels, now they get splitted, and therefore you get the fine information about each and every states separately. This fine information results into what we call in the spectroscopy as a fine structure. Correct? So this fine structure, from the gross structure, you can understand fine structure. If you go further, this fine may give hyper fine structure. So the each and every minute details, each and every states are separately studied using the concepts of perturbation theory. Correct? So this is the one example where we try to elaborate the concepts of perturbation and its role, how it can remove the degeneracy. I write this equation. The first equation, you can see where my cursor is moving. This first equation I can write slightly differently. If I write this separately with a determinant only made up of matrix elements H11, H12, H21, H22, and this W1 term, if I write separately, something like W1, I just subtract it. And if I write them, then you can see that minus W A1, A2 column vector that I take on the right hand side, the same equation you can also try. You can write this equation splitting this W1 term separately, and you will be able to write this term. And this W1, but now don't forget W1 has a two possible answers, one with a plus sign and one with a minus sign. Here is W1 plus and W1 minus. This discriminant term I have written with a plus and minus. So there are two possible answers. So you can have now two such equations, one for W1 plus and another equation with W1 minus. Though I have written here combinedly, but basically these are the two equations, one for W1 plus and one for W1 minus. So if there are two equations and there are two unknowns, A10 and A20, you can solve them. And only condition which we can impose here, that this A10 square, modulus square, plus A20 square should always be 1. And basically, this A10 and A20 are nothing but the coefficient or the cofactor of this linear combination. In fact, they determine the weighted average. They determine the weight of this state. If this is 0.7, if A20 is 0.3, means in this combination, UM1 contributes 70%. 0.7 means if I write in a percentage, it is a 70%. Whereas A20, that is the state number UM2, contributes 30%. If both are 0.5, 0.5, means you can say that state UM1 and UM2 contributes equally 50%, 50%. If A10 is 0, then you say that if A10 is 0, then your V0 is 100%. Return in terms of UM2. So this A10 and A20 are actually the weight factor. They determine how much is the contribution comes from the given state. UM1, how much percent? UM2, how much percent? So obviously, total contribution is always 100%. So we have this condition. Okay, lastly, now we have develop a theory for the degenerate case using the example of, say, doubly degenerate states, where the states, two states have the same energy EM. Instead of two states, now if you have, say, R-fold degeneracy, that means there are R number of states having the same energy, then obviously you can generalize these equations. Instead of this 2 cross 2 determinant, you have now R cross R determinant. So if I just generalize this degenerate case theory to R fold degenerate case, then what I get is this R cross R determinant, something like H11, H12, H1R. This is my first row. And similarly, if I go to the last row, HR1, HR2, and HRR. So basically, it is the R column R row, R cross R matrix, and instead of this A10, A20, obviously now we have this linear vector A10, A20 up to AR0, and W1 plus or minus, but now don't forget this W1 will have in general R number of values. So such R equations we can have. And similar to this, this is only for the twos term. If you have now R number of term, then this sigma sign indicates that you can make a sum. So you have to solve this equation. That's the idea. But now this is a cumbersome. This is a hopeless task. Correct? Because when you are solving this equation, you just go back. It was 2 cross 2. So you can open up this bracket. You multiply it to this. You make a quadratic equation. Correct? The equation which is the having a power 2. Now if you open up this determinant, then obviously it will be the polynomial of power R, and it is difficult to solve such a equation which is having the R number of power. Let us say even R equals to 10, then this is your 10 power equation. This was second power equation, quadratic equation for W1. If I solve it for say 10 cross 10 determinant, it will be 10 power polynomial equation, and you know that it is not a very easy task. So even if we say that our theory is developed, our concept is developed, but there is a practical difficulty in employing, in using this theory directly, right? Because use of this such a R cross R determinant is a practically very, very problematic. Even when you go with the say fast computing system, right? Or let us say on a workstation or in a cluster or on a, or even on a say supercomputer, such a problem is a very difficult to crack. And therefore, now we are looking to some method by which we can simplify this process. If it is possible to simplify this process, then it would be easier to deal with a problem, right? So though the method is developed, formalism is developed, the mathematics is developed, but because of this practical hindrance, because of this practical difficulties, we now try to simplify this problem. So for a degenerate case, how to solve such a R cross R determinant? That difficulty, that issue, that problem was solved by two mathematicians jointly, the Dalgarno and Lewis. Right? So this Dalgarno and Lewis have proposed a very simple technique by which this problem can be tackled. This problem of solving R cross R determinant can be done very, very easily. And idea is very simple. That even if you are dealing with say R cross R determinant here, but if you make many of this matrix elements inside this determinant zero, then you know that if there are zero, then my problem will be automatically simple. So idea is that before we make the calculation of such R cross R determinant, can we have any ways by which we can make the determinant or the many elements of determinant zero? Yes, that's the idea, that how one can make the different elements, as many as possible, different elements of this R cross R determinant to be zero. And for that, now what Dalgarno and Lewis has proposed, that you choose your UM alpha. Don't forget this UM alpha means here I have written UM1 and UM2 because it was doubly degenerate. But if you have a R number of such states, then I may write as UM alpha. So this UM alpha, where alpha can go as a 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So we choose our state function UM alpha in a such a way that many matrix element H alpha B beta. This H alpha beta means something like this, small H11, H12, H1R. And also don't forget this small H is nothing but a matrix element like this. Small H11 means it is UM1. H dash UM1. If I write H13, then it is like a UM1 H dash UM3. If I write H1R, means it is the Bray UM1 H dash UMR. So basically, this H alpha beta can be zero by properly choosing this UM alpha. So question is that how one can choose such UM alpha which gives me many matrix elements zero? And you know that it is always easy to deal with zeros because once in a R cross R determinant, say there are many elements 0, then obviously the things will be automatically simplified. So we are now looking for such a representation of UM alpha, which actually gives me many of the elements of this determinant 0. For that, what Dalgarno and Lewis has proposed, that you find some observable f. Instead of h and h dash, now you are dealing with one more operator which will be observable. And we know that this observable quantities are always having the corresponding operator as a Hermitian operator. So we are looking for those operators, physically observable operators, which are Hermitian operator, let us say f, such that this f commutes with both. F commutes with h0, so the commutation rule for f and h0 is 0. And even f commutes with h dash, whatever the perturbation you are using in your theory, if f commutes with this h dash and h0, then this f can help you to make the many of the matrix elements 0. So solving this r cross r determinant such that many of their elements are 0 requires now that you can find some f, some observable, some physical operator f, who can now commute with h0 and h dash. How this actually helps us, that I give as a proof. So what Dalgarno and Lewis have proposed, that we can make this calculations easy by making many of this determinant elements 0 by selecting, by choosing our f, so that f and f commutes with h0 and h dash. But really it will do it. So let us have a proof. What is the choice? That your f and h0 should commute, f and h dash should also 0. So we start with this statement that h0 and f commutes, h dash and f, they commute. Important implication of this, whenever any two operator commutes with each other, let us say when operator h0 and f commutes, then important outcome of this commutation rule is that whatever eigenstates of h0 are there, they will also be the eigenstates of operator f. So they have a simultaneous eigenstates. Whichever eigenstates you have for h0, they will also work as the eigenstates for f. And we already know that h0, that is an unperturbed part of the Hamiltonian, is always the exactly solvable problem. And when I say it is exactly solvable problem, means I know everything about each and every eigenstates of h0. So I know what are the eigenstates of h0. And if you say that your f commutes with h0, that means whatever eigenstates of h0 are there, they will also be the eigenstates of f. Of course, eigenvalue will be different because now your operator is not h0, it is f. So what I have written in the second line, that if um alpha are the eigenstates of h0, then your f will have the same eigenstate. Simultaneous means they have the same, common. So this f, when operates on the um alpha, then you can see this f will also, after operating, we get um alpha back. So it is also the eigenstate, but eigenvalues will be f alpha corresponding to this operator f. And then now I use this second identity. You know that this h dash and f also commutes. So if I write this h and f dash commutation rule, then if I open up, then it is f h dash minus h dash f, that is also 0. Okay? So this contribution f h dash minus h dash f, I can now use, and then I make a sandwich. I can now take a matrix elements of this commutation rule from the Bray um alpha, between um alpha and cat um beta that you do. So I'm now taking the matrix elements of this this commutation rule between the Bray um alpha and um beta. You can see in the next line, that's what I have written. I'm unable to move my cursor, right? So you can see the second line, the where I have written the matrix elements. And you know that f is also the observable. And when I say F is observable, means it is the self-adjoint or Hermitian. So whether I write F or whether I write F bigger, it is the same. And therefore, here you can see on the first term here that F operates on left side, whether it's F dagger, but F dagger and F are same. So F operates on left side, then we have F alpha UM alpha like this. And here on right side, when F operates, it will give F beta and UM beta. Right? And then this F alpha and F beta, I can write commonly. And you know that this is the UM alpha H dash UM beta. So it is nothing but the matrix elements H dash alpha beta, or as per this textbook, this matrix elements I can write with a small h alpha beta. We know this alpha and beta, if are different, if they are not same, then F alpha and F beta usually will not be same. F alpha and F beta, if not same, then this bracket will not be zero. So what can be zero? It must be this h alpha beta. Don't forget, this h alpha beta are nothing but the matrix element, something like H11, H12, H21, whatever we have written here, they will be zero. Idea is that now you can see many such H11, H12, H22, like different elements can be made zero. Correct? So my large number of matrix elements in that determinant, I can make zero. We will see the practical example of it, so you can actually realize. But idea is very simple, that if you are solving such a R cross R determinant, it's a very headache of job. It's a very difficult task because it's a very complicated. So what we have done, instead of finding the directly solving this R cross R determinant, now we depend on some operator F who commutes with H0 and H dash. And using this F, we will see as an example, we are able to make many of the matrix element, like here I have shown in the bracket, in a box, H alpha beta, I can make zero. So that will actually gives me idea that how one can simplify the problem to make this R cross R determinant smaller, or you can make many of the elements in it zero, and then you will be very easily solve that matrix, determinant, and you can find out the energy eigenvalues for the first order term. Right? So this Dahl-Garneau and Lewis technique, that is what we will be using next time, in fact tomorrow only. And we, as a example, we consider the hydrogenic system. It's not only hydrogen atom, in fact, but all those systems who have the similar structure, similar configuration to hydrogen atom, all those hydrogenic system we can use. And as an external agency, as an external perturbation, now we will use electric field. And you know that this is something like your atomic or a molecular system in presence of uniform electric field, and the effect is known as a Stark effect. Instead of this, if you put your system in an external magnetic field, then it is known as the Zeeman effect. Correct? And again, you can have whether the magnetic field is strong or whether magnetic field is weak, depending on that you can have the normal Zeeman effect or the anomalous Zeeman effect. So here idea is that such a Dahl-Garneau-Lewis technique can be used to understand the actual experimental observations in the Stark effect or in the, say, Zeeman effect. So tomorrow I think we can start with the application of this Dahl-Garneau-Lewis technique for the actual experimentally observed problems, correct? So we investigate the Stark effect, correct? So that's the idea that we will take next time, that is tomorrow only. So today I think I stop here, and I try to convey the Dahl-Garneau-Lewis technique useful for a state where energy states which are the degenerate states, right? So perturbation theory is now fully developed for non-degenerate state as well as for the degenerate states. But as we have realized that directly applying the mathematical formula of degenerate state is not possible because the mathematics will be complicated. So we can simplify using the technique proposed by Dahl-Garneau and Lewy. As application of this Dahl-Garneau and Lewy technique for a degenerate case, tomorrow we will take the example of Stark effect. So with this, I just stop for today's recording here. and then I will pause a while for your any response or any questions, correct? So I just stop recording now.